brothers. Gotta get it together for sisters, for mothers and fathers and dad and dads. Get it together, come on, let's make it.
Gotta make it,
to make it,
to make it,
to make it,
to make something happen,
to make something happen,
to make something happen, let's make something happen.
Word to fight, word to fight.
Hello and welcome to When They See Us Vote. I am your host, Bree Newsome Bass. And today we're going to be talking about beyond voting. What comes once we exit the voting booth? How do we hold folks accountable? How do we make sure that we follow through on the agenda after that? And my guests today are Stephan Whitley, who's the organizer with One Wake, and Robert Dawkins, who is political director of Action NC. Stephan and Robert, thank you so much for joining today.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for having us.
Absolutely. So I would love, we always like to begin by just giving our audience some background on what you do. You know, here with When They See Us Vote, we really are trying to introduce people to folks who are doing it on the ground, not just talking about it, but really doing it in practice. And you both are that. So can I start with you, Robert? Can you just give the audience some brief background on who you are, what you do, and how you got into doing what you do?
Sure. I'm the political director for Action NC. I've been doing community organizing, political organizing since 2003, so quite a few years. After I graduated from college, I had a political science degree, and I did the minor in public policy. It's what I wanted to work on. As usual, the institutions that oppress us don't give us a chance to work in them. So I wound up selling cars, doing all kinds of everything except working in public policy or policing. So in 2003, the first chance to do community organizing came about with Acorn, and I went to work for Acorn in those days and traveled around the country setting up campaigns in Houston, Philadelphia, Atlanta. There was one other city in Columbia, South Carolina, and then back here where I opened the Acorn office. And since then, I've been with Acorn. I've been with Democracy North Carolina. Now I'm with Action NC as the political director.
Awesome. Thank you. How about you, Stephan?
Yes. So Stephan Whitley, organized with One Wake. And so I've been, well, first of all, One Wake is a dues paying membership organization that consists of 42 dues paying institutions in Wake County, mostly faith-based. And actually the way that I got into organizing was a little untraditional, so to say. I come from a criminal background, so to say, whereas I'm what they call a returning citizen. But while I was in prison doing 20 years, I actually went to college in prison. And one of my professors, man, him built a really good relationship. And so when I was able to go on campus at Rutgers University while in the halfway house, he came to see me and asked me, you know, what do I need help with? And basically, I told him a job. And from there, he basically reached out to Metro IF, which is the parent organization of One Wake, and said, would you guys hire someone coming out of prison? Because he understood my background of getting people organized in prison around issues to hold people inside the, you know, the officers accountable for the things they were doing. And so basically that's how I got into organizing, from, you know, a professor thinking that I was someone who deserved a shot, basically.
Amazing, amazing. Thank y'all again so much for joining. So I really want to talk about voting, right? Like we obviously the whole show is called When They See Us Vote. We've been talking about a lot of different aspects in terms of, you know, what does it require for us to really build independent Black political power? That's what we're talking about, right? But voting is a really interesting thing. I mean, it's still very controversial. And something that I know I encounter a lot is I seem to get people in one of two categories. For the most part, one is the folks who feel like I vote every election. That's all I got to do. That's all it takes. You know, just vote. And then other folks are like, I voted. I don't see any kind of difference that it makes. Voting doesn't make any kind of difference at all. What is the point in it? You know, how would y'all respond to that? Let me start with you, Robert. What is your response to that when people are trying to understand what is the function of voting and how does it fit into everything else?
Yeah, even though, you know, I'd like to see the end of capitalism. I'd like to see the end of us being constitutionally bound by a system that enslaved us, but I can't really do that right now. All that I can do is work on our issues and organize people around it, polarize it, try to make them make change. But in a representative system like we are here in the U.S., the actual electing people is only step one. So you're trying to elect people that me and Stephan work out here, that we mobilize and say what's important to you and try to fight on. So our goal is to elect people that share our interest, and then we can hold them accountable for what they promised us. The bad thing is in most places, like here in North Carolina, unless you're in a super progressive place, the people that are in office aren't going to be the ones that you elected that promised you to do anything. So you're trying, I hate to say this, you're trying to elect people that you either put in office on your agendas, or you're trying to elect the lesser of two evils that I can use the power that I built to influence them to come as close to my agenda as possible. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. What do you say, Stephan?
Yeah, my thoughts mirror a lot of what Robert was saying. The only thing I can say different is, so with One Wake in particular, we're actually, we have a get out to vote campaign in which we're making sure we, you know, make sure 20,000 plus members of our organizations and outside family members are registered and voting, you know, and make sure that they go to the polls. On top of just making sure that they vote, because you asked, why is it important to vote? What's the purpose behind it? It's pretty much the way that we hire people. A lot of times people think that, you know, the politicians have power, but if we only understood that we have power, so we're the ones who can actually say whether a person get in office or not if we show up. Unfortunately, we understand that the Black vote is the most inconsistent vote, and we have to do a better job with that. And so with our 20,000, you know, people we're getting voted up, we're also having an what we call a accountability session for the candidates on October the 13th, in which we will have 2,000 of our members on Zoom with all the, you know, officials that are running for election, and basically holding them accountable before election. So, you know, I think it's key to hold, we believe that it's key to hold them accountable before election, get them publicly to say that they will work with us on specific issues. And then, you know, we work together after the election, because it, we often know that once people get elected, they start playing a lot of golf, and it's hard to get in touch with them if you don't already set that precedent beforehand.
I would love for y'all to say a little bit more about that, because that's a dynamic that I have definitely seen, where, you know, we might have somebody who people like the voters like the person, you know, they're very popular in the community. And, you know, one of the conversations that is at the forefront right now is like the limitations of representational politics, right? So just because somebody looks like us and, you know, can maybe talk to us in a certain way doesn't mean that they're really representing our interest, you know, once they're outside of the room and in the office and doing what they do. So I would love to know more kind of about, one, how you deal with the scenario where the person does make the promises, you know, but then you've got to really hold them to it afterwards. Because I have encountered some situations where folks don't want to push back on the person that they like. You know, it's like, well, no, I like that person. How could they possibly be doing anything that is not in our interest? And then two, because Robert, you kind of spoke to this too. What if you don't live in an area where you're really able to elect somebody who is representing you? How then do you apply pressure in those scenarios? Would anybody like to start, maybe give us some concrete examples?
Sure. So, you know, one of the main things, Charlotte, in Wake County, I'm not sure if that's where Stephan is Wake, I think, are progressive, supposedly elected city and county boards. The problem is, once they get elected, the bureaucrats are able to tell them what they can do and what they can't do. And then they come back and give you the excuse of why we can't. So our whole time is, one, making sure that our message, well, one, making sure we have a plan, and we try to prepare for what we call externalities. So like, we're trying to push as much as we can to defund police departments, right? So when we go in, the first thing that you hear from city council is, well, Robert, this is all good, but we don't have the power over the police's use of force. So we don't have control over those. You have to show them where they do. and where the activism part comes in. I can work all day on policy, and it's hard if you don't have people in the street. So just to give you the example, we've made changes in Charlotte to the use of force policy. We've made changes to the citizen review board policy. We've made changes to a lot of policy. It didn't come from us just going and lobbying them. It came from when people got in the street way back in the day, and Bree ain't old enough to really have a way back in the day. But the earlier Bree day would have been the tribe. And so I can go and fight all day saying, on paper, you're not doing this right. We elected you, and you're going to get the excuse. But once somebody gets killed and tribe is in the street, the news isn't following me on the policy side. They're following what's happening in the street. Now I can go back and sound like that cop in that old movie where the guy said something that he didn't mean to say. And he said, you know, you didn't messed up, right? Now I'm able to go back to city council and say, see, now you know you didn't messed up. Now you're going to give us these citizen review board changes that you said you couldn't do before. And miraculously, you know what? We found a way to do what they already knew they could do before. So one is the inside game, staying on top of all of the policy and way to hold them accountable about what they're not doing. But it's really hard to do that when we're not in a season of upheaval. That's the bad part. When somebody dies, I get one little policy change. When the police beat somebody and everybody's in the street, I'm able to get another piece of policy change. But that's the bad part, and I wish we could fix it, but that's the system. And we're talking about people that we elected. We're not even talking about Gaston, North Carolina, Gaston County, where there isn't a Black person or a Democrat on the city council.
What are the factors that are coming into play when you'll talk about, you know, the elected officials get in there, they start playing golf, right? Can you kind of break down a little bit? What are some of those factors that once they get elected, they might make all the promises while they're running for office, but clearly there's other folks that are in their ear besides the community. Can you talk about some of those dynamics?
I mean, I think it comes down to just about any job, or a lot of jobs actually, in which a lot of people will do what you allow them to do. So if we're not holding them accountable, if we're not, you know, united and organized together, people are going to do what they can get away with. You know, a prime example is, so One Wake is, as I said, it's a member institution of a bigger organization that's been around for about 80 years now, called Industry Areas Foundation. And we have 60 organizations across the country. Before I came here, I was working in Brooklyn with East Brooklyn congregations, a sister organization. And so we were working with Mayor de Blasio, and we went to him prior 2 years before that, asked for affordable housing for senior citizens. And it was 2 years and nothing hadn't been done. And we went back to him, we didn't like the answers that we heard from him. And so we basically mobilized and put together 6,000 people in front of the City Hall. And we put another 1,500 people in front of Gracie Mansion. And within a month, we was able to get everything in order which we wanted and start getting those homes built for the elderly. And that's a $500 million project. But it takes us having power, you know. And so we talk about power being the ability to do or to act. And so we have two types of power, organized people and organized money. And if we can have these two things, then we can start to really gain power. But we have to be relational in order to do it. We can't just think that everyone is going to come together on whatever date we say we're going to do something, and nobody knows each other, you know. So we have to be relational and understand each other's interests, but also understand the interests of the people and who we're trying to hold accountable.
I wonder, can you say a little bit more about that, Stephan? Like when you are trying to build those relationships, and obviously relationships influence how we're able to pool our money together. I was just having a conversation with some Black folks who are running for local office, and they were saying that's one of the great hindrances that we run into is the ability to fundraise and getting our community to understand the importance of backing certain candidates. So what does that, like, how do you approach that as an organizer? How do you work to kind of build those relationships, and what do we need to be doing as community members to build those relationships?
Well, as organizers, the way in which we work on that is we put relationships first. So the first thing we do before we have a conversation about anything is say, hey, can we take a few minutes or even a whole meeting just to get to know each other? you know, to get to understand why you're doing the things you're doing. Because first of all, I need to know who you are. I need to know what you're interested in. Because if I don't know you, you know, we can say, yeah, we're going to work on anything together. But then I might realize that you're somebody I actually don't want to work with, or we might not have the same type of interest. Or once I get to know you, we can actually realize that, hey, we have a lot in common, or we have some things that outside of this, and just relationships pretty much, they make things go very smoothly as far as who you're going to deal with. You know, you need to know people. And so that's the main thing we do. And when you talk about organized money, you know, our motto is, that's why we're a dues paying member organization. So that way we don't need funding from anyone else. Because when you need funding with someone else, oftentimes they can have control of your situation, or they can actually stop it. Because if you need funding to do whatever you want to do, to hold some official accountable, he might have the same people who fund you, you know, in his organization or in his group, and they might stop your whole train. So that's just our keys to organizing.
Y'all brought up something really important, which is the need for consistency and how we don't tend to be the most consistent voting bloc. And Robert, you touched on something real interesting when you mentioned the defund the police movement, because that is obviously something that's really at the forefront right now. A lot of folks may not realize that the defund effort is largely at the local level, right? Isn't it? It's largely local officials that really kind of make those decisions around police. And we know that where we tend to be the most consistent is voting is really the presidential election. There tends to always be this like heavy focus on, you know, who's running for president, almost to the neglect of every other race that's going on the ballot. And there's some real key races that are going on. Can you talk a little bit more about that? Like how crucial a lot of those down ballot and local races are, and how those decisions impact us, and why it's important that we really plug in on who those decision makers are at a local level?
Definitely. So one, down ballot races for positions, and down ballot races for bonds and initiatives. So when you brought up a good point, what I've been trying to work on, and that's us at Action NC, is first letting people understand what defund the police means. And then secondly, show them how we think inside game wise it needs to be done. I get a lot of activists that come and say, you know, we're just going to shut it down and we're just going to defund it. But that's not how it's going to have to happen. What we had to do is bring people in and say the biggest thing that we've got to work on is in the city's control. And it's that city budget. And even though people really like to jump on the part about taking part of the police's money and giving it to some other department, that's not really how it works. The main part for us to defund the police is Charlotte has 1,800 police officers. You know, it's got a $290 million budget, but the $290 million budget is mainly 88% of that is salaries. So while people want us to just go and fight for the $20 million, let's go and get rid of that. No, I've got to show you and figure a way to replace the police, because that's where their budget is. So, and I have to have these same conversations and try to bring people down to talk to city council people, because they're like Democrats too. Well, Robert, what if we cut 5% of the police budget and then we used it? And I have to say, and I don't know if you can cuss on the show, that don't mean a damn thing to me. Because that 5% that you cutting ain't going to stop anything. What I want to do is find out in the budget why you are justifying 1,800 officers. How much of those 1,800 officers' time is spent on things that they don't need to do, like shooting black folk in the back, pulling me out the car, and making me take my pants down. And why you got to cut my seats? You got to cut my seats. You cut my seats, now I got to buy new seats. All of that is wasted money. And what? How can I take that money and then reallocate it to like a CAHOOTS program? Because if you just take that little 5%, it's not going to fund their replacement. It's go away money. So it's institutional, and trying to get people to understand that the only way to change the institution is from the inside. As much as I'm going to do direct actions, the main reason that the direct actions happen outside the city council building, it's because that's the white folk with the power. So I need to get some black people that we know that represent us up in that building so that we can then talk to them intelligently about what we want to see. Stephan hit on a really good point. It isn't that all of the people that go in decide I'm going to play golf. They become institutionalized. So you got elected as a representative from the black district 3. But now you sit on city council that's controlled by Bank of America, Duke Energy, Wells Fargo, and they tell you the only way that I can do something for your small black people in District 3 is if you vote to help us build a Panthers a new stadium. And by the way, when we build them stadiums, we're going to make sure that some black people get jobs. But I don't want no damn job flipping burgers. I want a job that's going to feed my family. So he comes back and tells you as the city council person what he thinks is in his control. You know, if we vote along with this stadium, I'm going to bring jobs. And then you get black people in community that need jobs because they're not informed saying, well, that's a job I can get. No, that's a job you don't want. What we don't want to do is help him spending his time talking about Bank of America. We want him spending time talking truth to Bank of America about what we elected him for. But it's not that they forget it. It's not that they're not trying to be still black, but this institution that enslaved us also switches and enslaves the people that we elect, if you don't check it, not by their intent to be bad. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. How do we do that political education? I mean, that's something that we obviously come up against time and time again. Like, I'm sure y'all are aware, I'm doing a lot of work around housing, right? And, you know, there was a period of time we were trying to build a citywide housing coalition. Folks come to the table. They're like, you know, we want to change this policy. We want to change that policy. Some of those policies are at the state level. So, you know, we might be showing up at city council demanding things. And then the response we get is, well, y'all have to take that up to Raleigh. You got to take that up to the state legislature. So how do we like practically go about making sure that our community is informed, making sure that we have that understanding of the institutions that we're trying to infiltrate, take apart, work an inside outside strategy?
Little bit of pushback on that is that's also the excuse. So our whole thing as a resident, not a citizen, people love to say citizen, but as a resident, is to point out what we won't change. Don't give me that excuse. Well, you got to take it to Raleigh. No, hell no, you got to. I'm going to take it to Raleigh, but you go giddy up and come up here to Raleigh with me because you're still committed too. You have a thing called a legislative agenda. Don't send me up there by myself. You're going to come walk the halls with because you need to say the city of Charlotte and the city of Raleigh, the two largest bases of the city, want a state, want this change. Because us just going to lobby without the city and the county both saying they want it is just passing us off to somebody else to send us back home empty handed.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Bree, I was thinking that we have to educate the people. But unfortunately, we live in a day and time where everything is microwave, so to say. Like, everybody wants everything immediately. Social media, everything is at your fingertips. And unfortunately, at times, I think it's dumbing us down. People are not thinking on a critical level anymore oftentimes because they're used to, you know, a few caption words and to get, you know, attention. And so we have to find a way to make things fun. You know, we need to make it so that instead of people being so excited about Instagram and Facebook, they're excited about learning about how to make change in their communities. And so it takes creativity. But in a lot of senses, if you can make maybe get the children to start, you know, having fun with it, because children love to learn. And then that parent, oftentimes, if the child is liking something, the mother is going to want to know what's going on. And then the mother come by, and anybody know, anytime you get the women, then the man got to come and find out, hey, what's going on with my, you know, with my women at? So, you know, I think that's how you get the family. You start with the children, you get the mother, and then you get, you know, the men.
Stephan didn't hit on something really big, though, Bree. We've internalized ourselves that politics, you know, I don't want to go to a city council meeting. I don't want to do this. I would rather somebody tell me about it. Stephan's point on critical thinking is really huge. But us trying to reimagine what we consider is worth our time is the big thing. And people believe that I'm supposed to elect a person, not keep them honest, and come back and complain 4 years later because things didn't go our way. But at the same time, you had an obligation to hold that person accountable in whichever way. You know, we talked about social media. It might not be in the best way. But if what you're good at is social media, you can light one particular council person up all day that your social reach is now beating on them. If you want to be in the street follow that person from his house in the morning. Hey, I still came to check to see where that money at. So I came by your house to check to see where the money at. I know where your office is. I'm coming back later on today to see where that money at. You know, if it's academically, then go and give people presentations. The best thing that happened from your housing thing that you facilitated was trying to identify where everybody had a place to fit in, and then getting people to commit to it and letting people know that it doesn't stop on election day. Because remember, though, Bree, we had to go back and look because you found, okay, they passed a policy. You're gonna make sure 20% AMI is built. But now you're going to go and give it to a developer that didn't make the commitment. So then we had to rally up and go down there and shoot that down. And people are like, can you shoot it down? Yeah, when 80 people show up and not calling out the developer, but calling out the politician. You said you was working with us. You said you were going to make sure 20% AMI was going to be done. And you're the one letting him get away with not having the 20% AMI. And the camera's there. And then he has to say, well, yeah, you're right. I'm going to vote against it. Well, if you're the champion for it and you vote against it, then everybody else going to vote against it. And then we rolled out.
Yeah, well, what Robert is referencing for the audience, we have been working on this effort to like build a citywide coalition around housing. And exactly like Robert was saying, you know, we had a situation, and I'm sure folks see this in cities and communities all over. You have a lot of individuals in the communities. They're doing great work, but folks are not necessarily in communication with each other. You know what I mean? And so when we're talking about like trying to build that collective power, we really have to be able to like come to the table practically and talk about that, because there's like an endless list of things that have to be done. There's housing for seniors, right? There's housing for our returning citizens, and there's people doing work around all these specific things. Some people love to do the direct action. Some folk, they just want to focus on the policy, you know, and we need both of those things. And so we had to like do this practical work of bringing folks together, kind of identifying like, you know, what role do you want to hold? What role do you want to hold? How can we put all those roles together and really build something? We had to fight tooth and nail to just get the city to even just put into official language that there was going to be a process for community input. And what have we been doing since then, Robert? Fighting to actually make them follow through on that. And there have been times we've had to, like, you know, load up buses and bring people up to the city council so we can show up and show out, you know, to really, you know, put that pressure on them. And I would love to talk a little bit more about that, because one of the things that drives me crazy as an organizer, and I really feel like it's a narrative that has been pushed a lot by the political establishment, by the folks who don't want us to hold folks accountable, is they try to make it seem like protests and direct action are at odds with like voting, right? Like protest is something that you do when you don't have the ability to vote. And then once, you know, you have the ability to vote, it's kind of like, okay, well, y'all go home. You know, y'all don't need to do anything else. And I think that's part of what has contributed to this idea in people's minds that it's like an either or thing, right? So can you talk just a little bit more like about that in your experience, like how you have to, why it is important for us to understand that it's gotta be a both and, even if you as an individual don't wanna do both, right? Because everybody in our community can't march in the streets. We understand that, that's okay. But so long as folks understand, like we need that both and.
I'll let Stephan go, because again, he's a member of IEF. One person that really spoke on this was Saul Alinsky. So I'll let him hit you, and then I'll come behind if he needs something.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I mean, so for us, you know, it's key for us to be able to have the ability to be organized so that we can mobilize, you know, consistently and persistently. So that's the key, being consistent and persistent about it. And making people know, it's like a reputation. If you have a reputation for something, people understand that even before you come, that before they get into a fight with Mike Tyson, before he started losing, the guy already understood that more than likely I'm about to get knocked out in the first round, you know? And so it's the same type of thing that you have to build that type of reputation with people by being consistent and persistent, you know, showing out, as you were saying. And so what we try to do is make sure that at all times we organize in a sense where we get all the people, as many people as possible there, and then make sure we hold the people accountable, but stay on top of it. You can't leave it, and you can't let them try to control your movement by things that they might say or give you brush off tactics. you know, and oftentimes that's what they do. They'll try to play nice, sometimes try to cross the line between public and private, and we have to keep it, you know, business, so to say. But I'm gonna let I'll let you go, brother. I was just thinking about that thing y'all talking about, is the housing, because that's something we're definitely trying to work on here. And, you know, we've done a great job with that in other states like New York, building over 7,000 affordable houses and apartments. And so very interested about talking about it offline with you guys about that as well.
Maybe we can send Bree up there, boy. Bree be hell when she get her chalkboard and her her pen. She'll be able to get through that plan to be laid out. And she'll say, Bree will hit you with the what I think I'm hearing from you. That's a commitment. Write it down. But what you have to do is also with voting, the reason that people feel that voting isn't important is because people do not break voting down and ask them what is the issues that they want to see changed and how they want to see it changed. So what happens is we let white people and systems tell us what's the reason that we need to be voting. So that was all last year. A lot of people in my neighborhoods, I knock on the door and they say, if you come in here to tell me about Trump and China, I don't give a damn because I ain't Trump and I ain't in China. If you come in here to tell me about how you gonna get my check to come on time that I ain't seen yet, if you're going to tell me how they're going to come and make sure my kid's getting his benefits, then you're telling me something that I'm willing to vote about. So we need to invest time in breaking why you should be going out voting at the city level to things that people care about on the city level. And you need to be telling them on the national level, don't just go and tell me, go and vote because Trump is a racist, because most of the people in government's racist. He's just the worst racist. What we want to hear is, what are you going to do to benefit our community? And the party and stakeholders are quick to have these pre-made messages that don't reflect our concerns. So that's why people are naturally turned off from voting. You're out telling me what's your interest of voting and how you, it's called a frame. They know what they, why they want you to vote. Now, how do I take that and frame it to Black people to get them to go vote? We don't want the frame. We want to know that you're really concerned about us and our issues are reflected. And that's what we've got to do a better job of, or nobody's going to have faith in voting. For the people that aren't on the street level, a lot of times on that, we've got to also show that the people that are marching are the people in my neighborhood. Because if the folks are marching are all middle of the road, socioeconomic Black people, and it's not including our people in our neighborhoods, then they don't feel like that's for them. You know what I mean? Or if they go out and 500 people marched yesterday, and then the next day is 300, and then the next day is 100, people stop coming, and government says, it's great that y'all playing in the street, but you losing momentum instead of gaining. So whichever lane you're going to be in, have a plan and make sure that the people you're selling it to don't think that you're just giving them something to get them to come out and be involved. You really care and your message is about them.
Robert, you hit on something huge that was like one of the biggest revelations to me when I first started getting into organizing. I was given this assignment where I was supposed to go out into the parking lot with like a clipboard and, you know, a little survey. Listed like all these different issues. And I'm supposed to ask, you know, the people in my community, like rank, you know, how these issues affect you. This is the 2014 midterm election, right? And I can't even tell you what all the issues were that were listed on that, but housing was not on there. And that's the thing that I remember about it, was that the number one thing that was coming up in my community was folks checking other. And they were saying like, number one is housing and wages. And it was not even like on the ballot. It was not even something that the politicians were talking about. But then they're asking me to go out into my community and turn people out to vote. Right. And it was like from there that I really started to understand how, okay, there's like this whole structure where there's people that are like sitting at the top with like billions of dollars, and they're having meetings at like exclusive hotels, you know, up in DC, and they're determining way ahead of time before I get my little clipboard and I'm going out into the parking lot what the issues are going to be for that election cycle and what they're funding. And by the time, you know, the money trickles down to my community, it's like pennies compared to what started at the, you know, the top. And I'm sure y'all know too, the money show, the time that the biggest amount of money shows up is when it's get out the vote. It's very hard to get money for political education, for direct services, for any other work that we're doing. It's, and then when it's election season, all of a sudden the money shows up and we want everybody out knocking on the doors. And you can kind of understand like why the community starts to take a certain negative view towards that, because it's like, why are you only showing up? Why do I only see these people? Why do I, especially like politicians, why do I only see you when you're asking me for my vote and not any time in between? And so, I mean, I know that that was really a major part of how I started with the housing work, because I was trying to see like, well, how can we organize ourselves so we can go on the offensive and force this to be the issue? But I'm curious what that has, how that has shown up for the work that that y'all have done in terms of like really trying to change that power structure, so we're not just being told, you know, show up and vote and then otherwise be quiet, but we are really setting the agenda and setting the demands for what becomes the issues in the election.
You got to hold these people accountable to what you told them to start before they hit you with the switch up. So like 2016, Keith Lamont Scott, everybody's in the street. Everybody's got a sign that says, why are you shooting black people? Why are you doing this? Even though we got a Democratic elected council, they did the switch up on us. It's hard to control the police. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, you know what? I've learned from Keith Lamont Scott that we need better housing, that we need more jobs, that we need, and I'm sitting here, I'm clapping. Yeah, that's great. More housing. Wait a minute, you left one piece out. What the hell are you going to do about the police? And that's what they did in Charlotte. They switched the whole message up on you. What I'm going to do so that you don't get what you want, and we know we owe you housing. We already been saying that for a while. We already owe you jobs. Let me talk about housing. Let me talk about jobs. And most of the community, that was fine. They switched up. And police, except for us to stay in the policy side, moved on and start fighting on the other issues. Those issues was important, but I want you to see how the switch up happens. Because we got a black mayor, I got respect for her, but she crafty. You know, if basically what she said was, if y'all won't worry about police, what if I build you some more housing and get you some jobs? You know, and that was the message, and people fell for it. And then 2 years later, when there's another police shooting, then everybody got back and say, oh, police shootings are still a problem. They was always a problem. And she didn't fix that. And by the way, if we didn't stay on top of her, she didn't build you enough housing either. That's that BS.
I think a key thing that you mentioned, Bree, you used the word agenda. And so that's what we started with from the beginning of our building our organization, because One Wake is a new organization just starting actually the beginning of this year. And so the first thing we did was for the last few years, meet with over 3,300 people and just ask them in Wake County, you know, what are your interests? What do you think? You know, what are your concerns? What is hard on you and your family or your loved ones or your community? And we came up with the agenda that people cared about jobs, a pay a livable wage, affordable housing, you know, better school systems. As you said, things changed though, Robert. And so right now, you know, if you're looking at people and you're asking people now, especially people of color, what's important to you, of course it's gonna be, you know, if I'm gonna be here tomorrow, you know, I'm sick of every time I go to a store that I gotta hear somebody say, all right, brother, be safe. You know, nobody else don't gotta hear this language. You know, no other ethnicity hears when they separate, all right, be safe from total strangers. And so, but agenda is important. How do we build agenda? But we have to have relationships. We have to come together, you know, and actually get a chance to listen to each other and don't just try to come together when it's time to mobilize, because at that point it's too late already.
Yeah. So I think this is excellent how we have really done a deep dive on like the, you know, the local work and what it really looks like in our community. Obviously, you know, this presidential election is at the top of folks' minds, you know, and, you know, we are, for anybody that is listening or watching, we are recording this conversation in September. So we don't know at this point as we're having this conversation exactly how things are going to play out. But we know there's a few scenarios, right? We know that we are confronting the potential of voter intimidation at the polls. We saw a situation up in Virginia where you had Trump supporters out front trying to intimidate people. We got the president of the United States, not even like covertly, I mean, overtly, right? Hinting to his followers that they should show up at the polls and basically try to police folks going in. And then on the other side of the election, we're not exactly sure if all of our votes are going to be counted or if they might be dismissed. You know, we have this whole situation going on over mail-in ballots. We're voting in the midst of a pandemic and trying to be, you know, safe as we go to vote at the poll. So I would love to know just kind of, you know, on your perspective, one, what do you think happens if Trump wins? Like, let's say he manages to win outright. You know, how should we prepare ourselves in the aftermath of that? And then if he doesn't win, if we are dealing still with the situation of him or his supporters not accepting the outcome and the type of situation that we might deal with that. Actually, the very first episode in this series, the very first conversation that we had began with the history of the Wilmington Massacre, right? And just the history of white backlash against Black political power and the efforts to suppress our vote. And then the third scenario is, Even if Biden wins, right? Let's say Democrats take the House and the Senate. We know that's not the end of the struggle, right? I mean, that kind of goes back to what we were talking about at the beginning of this conversation, that we can't just vote and then walk away. A lot of the folks that are running and are on the ballot, the agendas that they're promising us, even though they're not as bad as Trump, they're still not exactly what we need to happen. So I know those are like three different scenarios I threw at y'all, but I was wondering if you could, maybe starting with Stephan, if you could give me your thoughts on how we should prepare ourselves for either one of those three scenarios.
Yeah, so one thing I have to mention first is that, you know, our organization is a nonpartisan organization, so I can't speak specifically on any candidate. What I will say is that we work to make sure that we hold any candidates accountable. And so if we have enough power, we can get just about anybody to understand that it's in their best interest to work with us. And so that's what we've really just been working on. How do we make sure we generate enough power? You know, if, for instance, if our three organizations came together and worked on certain issues, we would have more power than just one of us working separately. And so this is the type of things that we're trying to figure out. How do we, we're one Wake and we're doing some great things here in Wake County already, and we're looking to do much more. But how do we also join with other organizations at time when it's needed to help to get enough power? Because oftentimes that's the key right there. We talk about how to, you know, hold these people in accountability once they get in office. The longer we're separated, the more we're divided, and they conquer us that way, you know. And so we might look strong at, you know, 1,000 people, 800 people, whatever the case may be. But what does it look like if we can get, you know, a few hundred thousand people together, you know, coming together collectively? Look at the civil rights movements. You know, they had to come and work together with each other. And so that's the things we're starting to look into now. How would it look, and who can we work with, you know, to gain more power? But that's the key to us, just power. And when we say power, it means the ability to do or to act. How much power do you have? Can you force people to do what you need them to do? If not, then you don't have power.
I think we're going to see a little bit of everything that you listed, Bree. I'm not old enough to know about exactly all of the strategy that was used in the civil rights movement. I was the kids of the folks from the civil rights movement, so it had happened. But I have lived through 2000 with the Bush-Gore election, and we could see that coming, but I don't think people were prepared. So when it got to the Florida ballots and the contesting and the people challenging votes, I don't think people were ready for it. We had never seen that before, but we're going to definitely see that now. I really do think that you're going to see people showing up, not the super racist Proud Boy. You're going to see the people that are the ones in the suit challenging people at the polls. Are you registered at this address? And we've got a plan for that. So I think everybody needs to check their voter registration status and make sure that the address is right. People are expecting the ID. The ID won't be the issue. It's going to be, does your address match where you're voting? And we need to have election protection people set for that. That's stage one. Stage two is a little bit out of our hands, but President Bush is going to rush to replace RBG as quick as he can to make sure that the Supreme Court is, you know, so leaning conservative that if this has to go to the Supreme Court over the votes, that he knows that, that there's enough conservatives on there to say the election was not legitimate. So again, that's the direct actions. That's the phone calls and pushing around this Supreme Court decision. And even though we don't really have a say in it, we can try our best to raise enough saying that the world is looking, and he backs off on trying to appoint it to set it. After the election, whether Trump wins or not, racist people are going to be mad, and there's going to be a price for us to pay regardless. If Trump wins, it's see there, we're empowered now to do whatever we want. If not, it's we're mad and you stole it from us. The people that are going to be in trouble are people of color. So we've got to still keep doing what we're doing, but we've also got to build mutual aid. And mutual aid is going to play in on this on multiple levels. Normally, when we're talking mutual aid, we're talking about feeding each other or services like that. We're going to have to come up with a mutual aid on what does it look like for those first few months to protect each other and to wear this through until the end. And I don't know what that looks like, but I think that mutual aid space has got to be prepared, because whether Trump wins or not, I think people are saying if Trump wins, it's going to get bad. But I don't think that people get that if Trump doesn't win, it's going to be bad, because being from the South and studying the Civil War, when the South lost, that turned the ex-Confederates that were the most racist into the Klan. So they spent their time then doing every bad thing that they could do. So, and I don't want to be the gloom and doom person. But one, make sure your registrations is up to date at your location, so that if you go to the polls and somebody tries to contest your vote, that's fine. Apply as much pressure as you can in this RBG replacement on the Supreme Court, because if it has to go to court, he wants the Supreme Court to decide in front of him, so he wants to stack it before the elections. And third, the mutual aid space starting to look at what it will be. Mutual aid. I don't encourage anybody to have to be, I'm not pushing for violence. You know, I keep my pistol. I ain't telling everybody else to, but I'm going to be doing mutual aid. My mutual aid will be loaded.
Thank you so much. Y'all actually already touched on the last question I was going to ask you, which is what we do. But I mean, you hit on it all. Check your registration. You talk about election protection and how people can volunteer at the polls. We've seen a lot of young people volunteering in the roles that often our elderly folks would occupy, because elderly people are more vulnerable during the pandemic. Making phone calls around the Supreme Court nomination and building mutual aid. Amazing. I just want to thank you all, Stephan Whitley, who is an organizer with One Wake, and Robert Dawkins, political director of Action NC. Thank you so much for your time and for imparting this wisdom on us. And thank you to the audience for joining us. This has been When They See Us Vote with Bree Newsom Bass. Everyone take care and recognize your power and step into it. Thank you so much.
So be sure to visit our site, whentheyseeusvote.com. You can see other episodes. We also have resources and toolkits available for you to educate yourself and to help educate your community. So as our wonderful guest said, we can do what needs to be done to empower ourselves and make sure we make democracy real.
Come on, let's make it.
Gotta make it.
To make it.
To make it.
To make it.
To make something happen.
To make something happen.
To make something happen.
Let's make something happen.